What factors lead individuals to pursue a life of crime? Are these outcomes determined by spur-of-the-moment decisions with lasting consequences? Or are there specific and persistent factors that place individuals on a criminal life path from an early age? This paper examines one such potential factor, childhood exposure to criminal activity. In particular, the author studies child labor in the cocaine industry. Does early exposure in this context make it more likely that individuals will continue to operate in the drug trade as adults? And if so, what are the mechanisms that drive this link? To provide some context for this question, cocaine is derived from the coca plant, most of which is grown in the Andean region spanning Bolivia, Colombia, and Peru. 90% of the coca grown in these countries is used to make cocaine, and children and adolescents are involved at all stages of the production process. While young children are employed in harvesting coca leaves, older children often assist with the subsequent transformation of coca into cocaine and with its transportation. To gauge the long-term effects of this childhood exposure, the author studies the impact of drug enforcement policies that affected the likelihood that children are employed in the coca industry. In 1999, Colombia, which was then the world's largest cocaine producer, implemented Plan Colombia, a US-supported military intervention aimed at cracking down on the drug trade. These figures show the resulting decline in coca production in Colombia and the corresponding increase in its world price as supply became constricted. These higher prices increased the financial returns to coca farming in neighboring Peru, and production expanded there until, by 2012, the country had overtaken Colombia as the world's largest producer. Notably, coca production is not evenly spread throughout Peru, and is confined to districts endowed with the appropriate agricultural conditions for growing it. Thus, the author studies the impact of the 1999 Colombian intervention on children who happened to live in coca-growing regions in Peru during the boom in production, who were of an appropriate age to be employed, and who therefore potentially faced an increased likelihood of being pulled into the cocaine industry during their childhood. She compares both the short and long-term outcomes of these children to those of their unaffected counterparts. These include children who were born in the same coca-growing districts, but in a different year, and so their childhoods did not coincide with the boom in production, as well as children belonging to the same age cohort as those in the treatment group, but who were unaffected by the coca boom because they were born in non-coca-growing districts. In the short term, the author finds that the 70% increase in coca prices over this period led to a 30% increase in child labor in areas that were suitable for coca production, with the effects largest for those who were 12 to 14 years old at the time of the price shock. This confirms that these enforcement policies increased the likelihood that children were employed in the industry. Correspondingly, there is also a negative effect on schooling outcomes. At the primary school level, the author finds no effect on enrollment rates, but there is a 30% increase in the proportion of students with a higher age for their grade, and a 28% increase in the probability of failing a grade. This implies that while younger children are still enrolled in school, they may be attending less often or spending less time studying. At the secondary school level, there is a large decline in enrollment rates at precisely the stage when students transition between primary and secondary school. In contrast to their younger counterparts, it appears that older students leave school entirely in order to work full-time. Thus, in the short run, an increase in the financial returns to coca farming increases child labor in the industry and reduces educational achievement. What happens in the long term? Relative to their unaffected counterparts, are treated children more likely to be engaged in criminal activity as adults? The short answer is yes. Individuals who grew up in coca-producing areas and who experienced high coca prices during their childhood are about 30% more likely to be incarcerated as adults. This figure shows that these effects are concentrated amongst those who experienced high coca prices in their early teens, precisely the age range over which child labor increases the most. Now, there are two potential mechanisms that could explain this result. On the one hand, children employed in the industry may have lower formal education and thus fewer job opportunities as adults. Alternatively, exposure at an early age may allow individuals to acquire expertise and contacts unique to the cocaine industry and thus pave their way forward in the drug trade. The author provides three pieces of evidence suggesting her results are driven primarily by this second narrative. First, individuals exposed to the cocaine industry as children are more likely to be convicted of drug-related crimes in the future, but are not more likely to be convicted of other types of crimes, such as property crime, sexual assault, or white-collar crime. Second, while price shocks to legal commodities, such as coffee and gold, also increase child labor, there is no subsequent effect on incarceration rates. Thus, it is child labor in illegal activities that drives the results, rather than child labor alone. And finally, the negative effects of childhood exposure to the cocaine industry exist even for individuals who move to districts with no coca production as adults. This implies that the effects are driven by exposure during childhood, rather than by contemporaneous exposure during adulthood. These results suggest that exposure to illegal activity in childhood can pave the way for a criminal career by providing individuals with industry-specific human capital. Interestingly, the author shows that policy can subvert this underlying mechanism by changing parents' incentives. During the period of high coca prices in Peru, the government implemented a separate and unrelated program which provided cash transfers to parents on the condition that their children attend school on a daily basis. This figure shows that coca-producing areas that implemented this program experienced a significant reduction in both coca production and child labor. This suggests that, at least in this context, policies that target incentives for child labor can potentially reduce the development of future criminal careers. To read more on this topic, you can check out the full paper and its references to other related research. These include papers studying how schooling decisions are affected by changes in labor market opportunities, work on the importance of location and other childhood factors on long-term outcomes, and finally, a broad literature studying crime and illegal markets.